welcome to Blair Academy's 170th Christmas Vespers. It really is a pleasure to be here with you tonight. It's a pleasure for me, maybe strange for you to see me in the room, but it really feels like I'm home. And so thank you for welcoming me here. I want to thank Pastor David Harvey, who is the minister of this church and who is a member of Blair's Board of Trustees. I'd also like to thank Matt Hilsden, the church sexton, who helped us get things ready Wednesday evening. And Erica Ulster, I refer to her as Church Mouse. It's her artistry that's evident in the greens on the windowsills. We're blessed by their hospitality. I'd also like to ask a favor. Please be aware of the candles on your side. If you are at any time concerned, don't hesitate to blow them out. Our safety is more important than the ambiance here. Let us tonight open our hearts to receive the joy of this day and also be mindful of all the ways that we're blessed, even while we pray for those blessings to abound elsewhere. Maya Angelou, who was at one time a poet laureate of the United States, wrote a poem for Christmas in 2005. I'd like to share that with you tonight, confident that were we all to unite our prayers, we would ask for these things. Let's hear the words of Maya Angelou, a Christmas poem, Amazing Peace. Thunder rumbles in the mountain passes, and lightning rattles the eaves of our houses. Floodwaters await us in our avenues. Snow falls upon snow to avalanche over unprotected villages. The sky slips low and gray and threatening. We question ourselves, what have we done to so affront nature? We worry, God, are you there? Are you there, really? Does the covenant you made with us still hold? Into this climate of fear and apprehension, Christmas comes, streaming lights of joy, ringing bells of hope, and singing carols of forgiveness high up in the bright air. The world is encouraged to come away from rancor, come the way of friendship. It is a glad season. Thunder ebbs to silence, and lightning sleeps quietly in the corner. Floodwaters recede into memory. Snow becomes a yielding cushion to aid us as we make our way to higher ground. Hope is born again in the faces of children. It rides on the shoulders of our aged as they walk into their sunsets. Hope spreads around the earth, brightening all things, even hate, which crouches, breeding in dark corners. In our joy, we think we hear a whisper. At first, it's too soft, then only half heard. We listen carefully as it gathers strength. We hear a sweetness. The word is peace. It is loud now. It is louder, louder than the explosion of bombs. We tremble at the sound. We are thrilled by its presence. Is what we have hungered for, not just the absence of war, but true peace, a harmony of spirit, a comfort of courtesies, security for our beloveds and their beloved. We clap hands and welcome the peace of Christmas. We beckon this good season to wait a while with us. We, Baptist and Buddhist, Methodist and Muslims, say, come. Come and fill us and our world with your majesty. We, the Jew and the Jain, the Catholic and the Confucian, implore you to stay a while with us, so we may learn by your shimmering light how to look beyond complexion and seek unity. It is Christmas time, a halting of hate time. On this platform of peace, we can create a language to translate ourselves to ourselves, and to each other. At this holy instant, we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ into the great religions of the world. We shout with glorious tones the coming of hope. All the earth's tribes loosen their voices to celebrate the promise of peace. We look at our world and we speak the word aloud, peace. We look at each other, then into ourselves, and we say without shyness or apology or hesitation, peace, my brother. Peace, my sister. Peace, my soul. Will you say it with me? Peace.
Living blamelessly according to all the commandments and regulations of the Lord. But they had no children because Elizabeth was barren and both were getting on in years. Once when he was serving as priest before God and his section was on duty, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and offer incense. Now at the time of the incense offering, the whole assembly of the people was praying outside. Then there appeared to him an angel of the Lord, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was terrified, and fear overwhelmed him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will name him John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He must never drink wine or strong drink. Even before his birth, he will be filled with the Holy Spirit. He will turn many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. With the spirit and power of Elijah, he will go before him to turn the hearts of parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah said to the angel, "How will I know that this is so? For I am an old man and my wife is getting on in years." The angel replied, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. But now, because you do not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time, you will become mute, unable to speak until the day these things occur."
Thank you. Reading from Luke, chapter 1, verse 21 to 25. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondered at his delay in the sanctuary. When he did come out, he could not speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He kept motioning to them and remained unable to speak. When his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. She said, "This is what the Lord has done for me. And he looked favorably on me and took away the disgrace I had endured among them."
Thank you. proclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. For why has this happened to me that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child of my womb will be with fertility. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. Word of the Lord.
Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all the peoples. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors, and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins, by the tender mercy of our God. The dawn from on high will break upon us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly.
Thank you. and for Augustus, that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee, Judea, to the city of David of Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver a child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in the manger, because there was no place for them.
A reading from Luke, chapter 2, verses 20, or age 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and in the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those who are in favor." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph, and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherd returned, glorifying and praising God for all they have heard and seen, as it had been told them.
Thank you. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5 and 10 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and without Him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in Him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome Him. He was in the world, and the world came into Him through Him, yet the world did not know Him. He came to what was His own, and His own people did not accept Him. But to all who received Him, who believed in His name, He gave power to become children of God. Children who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 19. He is the image of the invisible God, firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell.
Thank you.
Yes.